A couple of years ago, a couple of us gamers got together, and at that point of time, I was still a lawyer, but we've always been passionate about gaming. So at that point of time, we had some really great engineers who had come up with a really phenomenal invention, so to speak. They had designed pretty much a better mouse. So from that perspective, we realized that, you know, a lot of gamers wanted a better product, they wanted the unfair advantage, and that's how Razer was started, you know, to kind of bring the unfair advantage to gamers worldwide. And I quit my job, and the rest is history. I think along the way, Razer has seen a lot of changes. So I think back in 2005, I think that was when we kind of definitively said, this is going to be a real business for us. This is going to be something that we want to be passionate about and grow the business. So yeah, it's been a couple of years and it's been good fun. I enjoyed my time as a lawyer. But it's one thing to be passionate about a job and another thing to really want to make a difference. And I think with Razer, what we've done is we've reached out to millions of gamers worldwide. If you go check out our Facebook fan page, we've got like over a million fans over there. And every day, you know, gamers are trying to find out a little bit more about our product, you know, our designs, so on and so forth. So it's exciting work. We didn't really treat it like a real business in the early days. It was more like a fun job for us. It was a passion. So while I was studying and while I was playing games at the same time, I was pretty much giving all kinds of feedback in terms of how to design a product for a gamer. So today we have this mantra, we've got this motto, for gamers, by gamers. When I left my job as a lawyer, you know, everyone said I was crazy. And back then gaming wasn't like an industry. No one talked about it as something you could make a living out of. But, you know, sometimes you just do crazy stuff, right? You just want to do something you really want. And I think that was one of the times of which I said, look, it's either I do it now or I might regret it for the rest of my life. So I said, to hell with it. I'm just going to jump off the deep end. I'm not going to care about the traditional doctor, lawyer path and stuff like that. The crazy thing is, we've always been profitable, I think, from the start, primarily because we were designing a product that really resonated with the gamers. They really wanted it, and it has been a success since day one. I get this question a lot, like, what was the biggest challenge, or what was the biggest obstacles and stuff like that? And it's either I've been insanely lucky, or I just don't see any of it as an obstacle or a challenge. Every time there was I wouldn't even call it a setback, or I would say an issue, we would all sit together and we just solve it. We just want to stay true to gaming and true to what we believe in. And when we first started, computer mice, for example, they were a commodity. But we came up at a product that was like five times the price of a computer mouse. But it resonated with the gamers. We focused on the customer first, the gamer, and it just came up along with that. We really look at pushing the envelope in terms of technology, in terms of innovation. And the Razer Blade today is the thinnest and most powerful laptop in the world. We don't have a specific strategy of sorts that we have to go global. What we do is that in everything that we do, in every design that we come up with or every decision that we make, we have only one thing in mind, and the customer, and in this case, the gamer. We just went to where our customers were. So in the past 5 years or 6 years, we've been pretty busy. We are headquartered out of California. So we've got three offices in the US. In Germany, it's a massive PC gaming population. We set up our European headquarters in Hamburg. In Asia, because, you know, I was born in Singapore, you know, we set up one of our Asian offices in Singapore. We've got about 200 people over here. We've got offices in Korea, China, two offices in China. So we kind of went to where the gamer was, as opposed to having any kind of formal business strategy. It's the business of fun, you know? Not just the business of fun, it's the best business there is. Now, gaming today has become the fastest growing segment in entertainment. It is bigger today than movies. It is bigger than music as an industry. To put things in perspective, if you think about it, for the past couple of years, the box office weekend takings of the three largest box office hits consistently have been smaller than the biggest game launched, you know, for the past 3 years. Whether you're talking of Pirates of the Caribbean, Spider-Man, Iron Man, so on and so forth, all that have paled in comparison to gaming. So gaming is serious business. Now, I suppose you can take it from a real serious perspective, but for us it's a passion, so that tracking the numbers isn't exactly what we get obsessed with day in, day out. I'm more obsessed with the fact that I'm leveling up on my Star Wars The Old Republic character at this point of time. I think correspondingly we run this a bit like a gaming organization. So when you play StarCraft, it's all about maximizing resources and then spending it and making sure you get great returns on all that kind of stuff. So, for example, recently we decided after a couple of years to seek venture capital funding. And we raised in our first round $50 million. So with those resources, we are looking to bring that in terms of focusing in strategic areas, whether it's user interfaces that we do phenomenally well at today, or gaming systems, software, so on and so forth. We took a little longer to raise venture capital, primarily because we were so focused on delivering product to our customer. And seeking capital wasn't really on top of our list of priorities at the start. For us, raising capital was to allow us to go into greater amounts of greater areas, and for us to really do a lot more with the resources that we have. The money has never been a priority for us. For us, it's really the contacts and the kind of value add that the investors bring to the table. That has been more important for us than just an investment. Finding the right person or mindset is critical. We don't really look at qualifications, you know, whether the guy has MBA from whatever or anything like that. That usually isn't the first thing we look at. We look at passion, whether he or she really understands what Razer is about. You know, our commitment to making really phenomenal product, perfect product. Why would anyone want to work in a place where they're not really passionate about the work that they do? So over at Razer, what we do is we're really passionate about gaming. We're really passionate about our user base. We're really passionate about creating some great product. So gaming is a bit of a subculture. You know, we've got our own language, we've got our own, they will know if you're a fraud or not, you know, immediately. As our company grew, there's like other competitors. They were like, wow, you know, Razer's doing so well, we want to hire a bunch of suits and let's find out how to compete with Razer. But the thing is this, if you don't have an organization that from bottom all the way to the top that is really passionate about gaming, there is no way to compete. Because how many gamers, how many CEOs out there actually play games? And this includes a country. Now, if a country really wants to get into the gaming business, it has to embrace gaming from the get-go and realize that it's not a bad thing. Anything in excess can be a bad thing. But anything in moderation and with a good perspective can be phenomenal. We started with user interfaces. So today we are probably the world's number one, I think, when it comes down to gaming user interfaces. We created this entire industry, so it's been awesome. Now we've kind of evolved and moved to bring in a lot more talent. And with this engineering talent and software talent, and with very passionate people, we've kind of gone out there and broadened our product line with the Razer Blade, for example, the gaming laptop. That's a huge step for us. Gaming has been recognized as a real business, and not just that, gaming is also recognized as probably one of the biggest segments for a long time to come. I think the difference in culture perhaps is that gaming is a little bit more accepted in the US, but in the early days it wasn't so much accepted over here. But that much has changed, it has evolved too. So the Singapore government, for example, I understand is really encouraging startups in the gaming space. That's something we've really realized along the way. I think we've got, over here in Singapore, a huge pool of talent. That's why we set up a research and design center over here too. You know, that's why I don't think it's a cultural thing, to be honest. I think in every aspect, we found some of the most creative people over here in Singapore. It's really, however, from a management perspective too, to give them the opportunity to create great things. So, you know, when we first started hiring people, we had people who maybe when they first came in were a little bit more reserved, and after a while they said, wow, you know, here's a place where, you know, middle afternoon you can be playing games and people are saying, great, you know, there's work. When it's hard work, it can be like 24/7, everyone's kind of grinding and trying to get that. But when it's chill out time, you know, you can play games anytime. We serve you food at the office over here. nobody yells at you if you come in slippers and shorts. If somebody came naked, I wouldn't give a damn. We haven't exactly modeled it after like what we do in the Valley, for example, or what we do in Europe, so on and so forth. All of us have our own little cultural identity, but all bound by a single brand identity. In Singapore, what we've done is we've just created our own little oasis of fun, so to speak. I don't want to have to police the guys whether they're watching YouTube all day long, or and when I log on to a game, you know, everybody here who's on my Steam account will basically say, oh, Min is playing a game in the middle of the afternoon. We have our own little culture within the country, and then we find the people who are kind of fit within our culture to come within our organization. Some people like to have it, you know, like, give it to me 9 to 6 all day long, right? Over here, you know, you get people who come on the weekends, they stay late. We used to hire a guy who lived under his cubicle. I'm not kidding. He literally moved and lived under his cubicle. We don't believe that businesses have to be painful. Now, is it going to be painful, I suppose, from time to time when work needs to get done and, you know, there's a lot of pressure and, you know, let's get that thing going? Yeah, of course it is. But that's part of the fun. It's like playing a game, right? Looking at it as a competitive game also means that we must up our game on all aspects. It doesn't necessarily mean that we have to treat everything with disdain or anything. It's not that. So you realize that the best gamers in the world tend to be the most disciplined, and they practice. The Koreans, for example, they are the top professional gamers in StarCraft in the world. You know, they practice from 8 hours a day, consistently, over and over and over again to be the top. So we always want the competitive advantage. We want the best people on our team. It doesn't necessarily have to be painful. I mean, if you don't find that your work is fun, that's half your life. Are we a little unorthodox, I think, versus the typical 9 to 5, 9 to 6 kind of company? A little bit. People, when they come in, they're passionate about it. And they love what they do over here. And I think that's the important part. We realize that if somebody is a gamer, when he hits an obstacle, and it's just exactly like you hit an obstacle in any game, Mario Brothers or whatever, you can either give up, ask your superior, or you can find ways to just try to get around that issue over and over and over again. It can get a little obsessive. That's the kind of guys that we have, that they don't want so much management from a micromanagement perspective, but they have a huge amount of initiative. And that's how we've been able to succeed.